and George Allen from Virginia. And George Allen, I have to say, is running for his old seat this year from the Old Dominion. So these were the three individuals who I was told back in 06 were part of this whole network of recruitment. And this was at the height of, if you recall, the House Page scandal involving a number of members of Congress, including, of course, Mark Foley from Florida, who resigned because of that scandal. So we have, and then we had in 2002, Santorum awarding Sandusky this award as one of the adoption angels. It's quite clear that Penn State, Sandusky, Santorum are involved with one another. This whole practice, as I mentioned, of Santorum using his Senate office as a magnet and recruiting ground for staffers to go over to similarly inclined.
And let's be clear, the sports writer and newscaster who originally broke all this and forced it out in the open, he's been interviewed in Pennsylvania and said rich donors were coming there. Obviously, Sandusky's not raping children in the showers in broad daylight. If he didn't think, hey, this is, I mean, and of course, the police and others, it turns out, knew 15 years ago and did nothing. So this is the tip of the maggot pile.
Well, and here's another thing. I mentioned that Santorum was a member of the board of the Israel Project. That outfit's chief spokesman has now shown up at Penn State as the lawyer for Penn State to represent them in this whole pedophile scandal. And that guy is Lanny Davis. So Lanny Davis, who worked with Rick Santorum at the Israel Project, now shows up at Penn State. At Penn State, obviously, and many people think he's, you know, there to cover up. So there's a lot more to this than meets the eye.
I think it's great that the President of the United States has a date night with his wife. I think it's very, very important for him. He's a role model. He's a role model in particular, whether he likes it or not, in the African-American community. And you have an African-American community, particularly in the poor inner city areas. We're looking at out-of-wedlock birth rates, you know, in 75% of children being born out of wedlock. Marriage is an institution that's a bridge too far for too many African-American women and is not desirable in among African-American males. Here we have a President of the United States who's saying marriage is cool, marriage is something that you do, you have respect for your wife, and you treat her with the respect and dignity she deserves. And she's part of this team. And it's not just part of a professional team, but it's also part of a personal romantic team. I think that's all great. Has a date night with his wife.
I vote and have supported, birth control because it is not the taking of a human life. But, you know, I'm not a believer in birth control and as for artificial birth control. Again, I think it goes down the line of being able to do whatever you want to do without having the responsibility that comes with that. And I don't think it breaks what I think. And this is from a personal point of view. From a governmental point of view, I support, Title 10, I guess it is, and have voted for contraception and all that. I don't think it works. I think it's harmful to women. I think it's harmful to our society to have a society that says that, you know, sex outside of marriage is something that should be encouraged or tolerated, particularly among the young. And I think it has, we've seen very, very harmful long-term consequences to a society. So
concerns about this movement within the Republican Party and the Tea Party movement to sort of refashion conservatism. And I will vocally and publicly oppose it.
There is no such society that I'm aware of where we've had radical individualism and that it succeeds as a culture.
My general feeling is that we have a free market and the free market should work, but like any freedom, there has to be regulation. You're not unlimited in any right, even right that we have within our Constitution. They're not unlimited rights. Right that we have within our Constitution. They're not unlimited rights.
There was a war about nullification. The Civil War was about nullification. And I'm not sure I want to go there. If the state doesn't like what the federal government's doing and they believe it's unconstitutional, they can go to a federal court and they can take it up in a federal court. There's a process by which that states can litigate, number one. Number two, there's a process in which states can go to the federal government and get through their elected representatives and fight back through the congressional process. But for states to be able to basically say, well, we're going to pay attention to these laws and not other laws, prior to the Civil War,